nobody ever actually asks the question, is this a good artist?
5 million pounds. 5 million.
If you look at him very consistently across his work as a draftsman, as a painter, you would find quite quickly that there are some serious problems with his work throughout.
$49 million.
£22,500,000.
$75 million.
In my opinion, he was systematically a failure. My mother took me in 1961 to an exhibition in Toronto at the Art Gallery of Ontario. My strongest memory of that is the terrible sense of depression and despair that seemed to come along with looking at all these gloomy, dark paintings of impoverished and thin and angular and anguished peasants. And then finally everything seemed to become kind of positively joyful when you got to the paintings of sunflowers and irises and these brilliant yellow pictures of the south of France. But I also remember really strongly being deeply distressed by the way that the exhibition made me watch this man disintegrate. And finally, with the crows over the wheatfields, I seemed to be witness to his death.
There were very grey days after the war, and we didn't have much art, we didn't want much art. But I was absolutely knocked out. It was akin to losing one's cultural virginity.
My stomach began to react to these paintings. It was contracting. It was as though they were doing something to my intestines. It wasn't a violence, but it was an extremely powerful emotive response. And I actually did find myself with tears in my eyes.
Exhibitions manage our emotions. They tell us stories. When they organize pictures hanging on the wall, they shape the meanings we get from them. Countless exhibitions, books as well as films, have created the legend of Van Gogh. Now, this program is not another version of the same story, and it's not another interpretation of the artist. We want to investigate how meanings and values, symbolic as well as financial, got attached to a name and a few colorful pictures. We're going to take a critical look at how Van Gogh became synonymous with modern art. So we want to ask how an amateur Dutch artist came to symbolize the deep myths of 20th century culture.
Heyo! Heyo! Heyo!
Van Gogh has passed the limits of any other painter on earth, as far as I can see. Even the Michelangelo of the Sistine Ceiling is not as well known to the man in every street in every city in the world as Van Gogh is.
He's a bit like the James Dean of the art world, you know, the sunflowers and the Starry Starry Night, the song by Don McLean. I mean, that all goes into an incredible PR job.
It rolls out of control. Van Gogh just is Van Gogh, bigger and brighter and better and washes whiter than anything else.
People today want wallpaper. They want people to know what they have. You come into a room, you're showing your collection, and Van Gogh makes an impression, it makes an immediate statement, and it says something about you as a collector.
He wanted to make an art of and for ordinary people, and he succeeded. I think underneath it all is a very clever marriage of two opposite things. A very strong graphic style, which underpins supposedly flamboyant and expressive colour. And when people try to do the colour without doing the drawing underneath it, they tend to end up with a mess. But Van Gogh doesn't. It's because he's a genius.
There can be no doubt that Van Gogh has a distinctive style and produced memorable images. But we don't need to explain them by appealing to the mystery of genius. In fact, they're the product of the copybook apprenticeship of an enthusiastic amateur.
The key thing about Van Gogh is that he's self-taught. He's sitting there in a tiny mining village in Belgium, and he decides he wants to be an illustrator for contemporary magazines. And so he buys himself a few manuals, and he starts to draw. Now, these teach him certain habits, which are not the habits that you learn if you go to art school. Because if you go to art school, you learn to draw the human figure in the round. You learn to deal with the real question of art, which is how to make things that are three-dimensional make sense on a two-dimensional plane. But because Van Gogh basically learned to draw through the illustrations that he owned and through copying these manuals which emphasized the outlines, he became dependent on a kind of completely flat, two-dimensional graphic way of producing things. Now, this produces in some of his very famous pictures of peasant women and men digging and working some very busy drawings. I mean, like, there's a lot of work going on, there's a lot of charcoal being used. But when you examine them very closely, there's no structure to the bodies. All the, you know, the joints don't articulate, buttocks are vast, feet are grotesque, the way the arms articulate are completely mistaken and just incorrect. And these gross distortions don't actually hit you because there's such a lot of graphic activity. It's rather like looking at some of these illustrations from the graphic magazine, which he collected in their hundreds of thousands and used as his kind of imaginary museum.
Many of Van Gogh's images were inspired by banal and sentimental subjects which were popular in Victorian art. These form a kind of phrase book on which he depended all the rest of his life, so in crucial ways he always remained a copyist.
He did try portraits. Now, some portraits come off. Vast numbers of portraits have atrocious details. Hands are absolutely without substance, eyes are skewy, ears are multicolored, faces are distorted. Then, when he finds that he's not quite in control of the figure, he turns to landscape, which is one of the most difficult genres. And this is when the most interesting things happen. He tried to assist himself with landscape with a perspective frame, which is a device which you set up and you look through, and then your own canvas is marked up with similar lines, and then you can identify, locate, where the thing you're painting should be on your flat surface. Now, there's a little drawing here of him looking through that, and that's all very well. When he looked through it, if you take half of his picture, cut it off at the point at which he would have been looking through the frame, you get completely conventional perspective. It makes perfect sense. But then you have probably two-thirds or at least half of the canvas, which is blank. So what he did was to look down at his feet and paint the grass that at his feet and then sort of fill in the gap. So you have these extraordinary pictures that sort of leap into space.
And it's clear that Van Gogh had no consistent program.
It chops and changes literally from day to day which style he's using. There's no consistent program developing some problematic in art. You know, one day he's doing flat bold color with outlines, the next day it's vermicelli in paint. One day the clouds are all round and full, and the next day they're all kind of running streams of some kind of, you know, gaseous explosion. There is no sense here that this is somebody grasping the problems of art, like, for instance, Cézanne did, and saying, I'm going to dedicate my life to a disciplined analysis of what the problems of picture-making are, or what Gauguin set out to do. I'm going to abandon nature and see how far I can take the decorative. There is no program. And in that sense, art history has to invent this notion of the intensity of the man, the singular personality which holds it together.